Chapter 4, Christmas 1838. Do you want me to shake your hand, or did you hurt your hand and you're showing it to me? William asked puzzled, with a slightly teasing tone.
I was not.
Forget it, I was just clueless, Victoria replied a little embarrassed as she pulled her arm away from her husband.
My sweet wife.
William said affectionate and cheerful, as he approached her and hugged her and kissed her on the lips, a deep and prolonged kiss, and after breaking the kiss left his arms around her while he looked into her eyes, and both smiled. Do not let the Christmas stress overwhelm you, dear, did you enjoy your girl time with Nancy? He added.
Well, it was relaxing and interesting. I bought the things but I left them in the car, then I'll take them out, when the girls are not watching.
Victoria said with a knowing glance at her husband, and how our little ones imp have behaved got?
Well, Andrew is sleeping like an angel.
I fed him with the milk that you left in the fridge, William said referring to the breast milk that Victoria had removed herself with a pumping breast milk, and left in the fridge for give it to baby with a baby bottle. Bella is talking on the phone with a friend, about that, I heard, she said there was a guy named Harry Styles, and she said he was very hot, maybe you should start talking to her about guys and stuff, he added seriously.
Victoria laughed, to William's bewilderment.
William. Harry Styles is not a boy that Bella knows. He is a singer that belonged to One Direction.
You know.
One Direction? Victoria saw the face of confusion on her husband's face, as if she were talking about thermonuclear physics to someone who did not even know what nuclear energy was. Forget it.
Well, the boy is a famous singer, but also Bella is only 8 years old, she's too young for you to start worrying about her and the kids.
I do not want to think about how you'll behave when girls are teenagers. She added funny.
Well, if you say it, as for Lily, she has behaved very well. Now she is watching some movie on the computer, some children's thing on the video on demand service that I installed, replied William.
Papa, how do I look for Narcos? Lily asked loudly from inside another room.
Jesus Christ!
I told you, nothing to see series or movies for adults, Lily! Exclaimed William exasperated, I'll better see what she's doing. He added addressing his wife as he gave her a quick kiss on the lips and walked away from her. A while later the family was sitting at the table for dinner. Victoria saw William with curiosity, recalling the memories of her past life, remembering how she saw him dressed as Lord Melbourne. William noticed and felt a little uneasy.
Why do you stare at me, Victoria?
It's like you have never seen me before. And it's not that it bothers me that a beautiful woman sees me with such interest, but it seems a bit strange, said William with a funny and mocking smile.
No, for nothing.
I think I'm still clueless, Victoria answered. They kept eating, but Victoria kept thinking about the memories recovered by hypnosis.
Lord M.
Victoria exclaimed unexpectedly looking to cause some reaction in her husband, trying to awaken the memory of him. Her husband choked on the mouthful of food and had to drink water, while Bella and Lily saw their mother, they surprised.
What did you say?
William asked coughing, recovering.
No, nothing my love, a nonsense that I remembered, of a novel that Nancy recommended me, and I did not remember the name until now, Victoria exclaimed a little embarrassed.
Victoria, I do not know what's happening to you, since you came back this afternoon. You're acting in a very strange way.
Is there anything you want to talk about?
Said William seriously and somewhat worried.
Daddy.
Mummy is going crazy.
Lily asked seriously.
If someone ends up being crazy, in this family, it will not be me, Lily, Victoria said impatiently to her daughter.
Victoria.
William rebuked his wife.
Daddy, if Mummy gets sick, can I take care of Andrew?
Bella asked naively.
I am not sick nor am I going crazy, girls.
Victoria exclaimed seeing her daughters and then turned to see William.
I'm sorry, my love, you know that when Christmas approaches I become a little weird, and this year with more reason, with the birth of Andrew so recent and the pressure to get used to the fact that now we have three children at home, and the nanny is not here, and the Christmas Eve dinner is coming, and we are going to have the house full, and... Victoria. I already told you, you should not be overwhelmed, take it easy, I do not want you to get sick. I am here to help you, you will see that we survived Christmas, you do not demand much to yourself, said William, squeezing her hand affectionately. I know, William. You know how dramatic your wife is. We're going to finish dinner and then watch some television in family, Victoria replied, smiling. They kept eating, but after a few minutes Victoria opened her eyes, as if shocked. God, she had 9 children. I have to do me a tubal ligation. Victoria exclaimed in anguish. The girls gaped at their mother, and William was amazed. Well, it's enough. Girls, if you finished eating you can get up from the table and go to play or watch TV. I must talk to your mother, said William to his daughters. Daddy, can I take to Andrew? Bella asked, seeing her brother who was inside his baby carriage, next to the table, between his parents. Bella, your brother is not a toy for you to play with him, answered William. How am I going to learn to be a mother if they do not let me practice with my little brother? Bella exclaimed as she left. We hope that this is knowledge that you do not need in the next 20 years, young lady. William replied loudly while his daughters left. When the girls left the dining room, William turned to see Victoria. Victoria, seriously, what's wrong with you? William asked kindly, but serious and worried. William, my love. Victoria said, squeezing his hands with hers, have you ever felt that there is something missing in your life? As if you suddenly felt that you have lived other lives, that you have been in other places, and that there are situations in your life that remind you of those other times and places, and that make you feel nostalgic for those realities. Have not you lived ever a déjà vu? She added to the expectation. William was surprised, but then he was thoughtful and his face was covered with a gesture of sad nostalgia. It was once, it's funny, but I think that in so many years I have not told you, even though we've told almost all of each other of our lives. I guess it's because I do not like to talk much about the war. It was during the Persian Gulf War, you know, I told you the essential of my experience in the war, but there was a day, my companions and me were relaxed, we were in a sector away from the battlefield, in a break after of the action in the front. I walked away from the guys looking for privacy to put my thoughts in order. And then I saw some birds, I do not know what race they were, but they were rather small and black. They were on the branches of a tree, and suddenly a couple of them took off, and it was very strange, because I felt transported to another place. I felt like I was in the middle of somewhere in England, some garden or something, and I had the feeling that I had lost something, and I felt a pain in my chest, a very great anguish. I felt very sad and I wanted to cry, some tears fell from my eyes. And since then I was very afraid of being alone, even though I was so young then, well, I attributed it to the trauma of the war. The truth is that this fear of being alone, that strange feeling of loss helped to push me into the arms of my first wife, but of course she was not the remedy but all the contrary. I had kept feeling that there was a piece that was missing so that my life was complete and that anguish in my chest would end. And that's how it was until I met you and I fell in love with you, only then did I feel that the anguish was leaving my chest and that the missing piece fit, only then I felt that I had arrived home, said William with wet eyes and a smile sweet, with a look of love for his wife. Victoria began to cry, and came to kiss him on the lips, a deep and passionate kiss, which he responded enthusiastically. After the prolonged kiss, both of them turned their heads away from each other, and Victoria had William's head cupped in her hands. When you say things like that, I would like you to make love to me right now on this table, said Victoria, happy and excited. I do not think it's convenient, if the girls see us they would be traumatized for life, William replied mockingly, and both laughed. Then both shared jokes and sweet words, and kissed a couple of times more. Then they talked about the Christmas Eve dinner. "Everything will have to be perfect so that my mother does not crucify me," Victoria said resigned, sitting in the lap of her husband. "Victoria, your mother is not so bad," William replied funny. "You already forgot that she hated you when you married me," Victoria exclaimed, rolling her eyes. "Well, if I had been in her place, I would have done the same thing, if it had been an older man with my daughter, with Bella, or with Lily. But you know that we get along now," answered William. "Yes, but she do not forgive that you have not continued in politics, that you have not continued until being prime minister, and that her daughter would not have been the prime minister's wife. She thinks you waste your talent having dedicated only to writing history books and star in documentaries for television like Michael Portillo," said Victoria. "I thought that she liked Michael Portillo," he replied funny and mocking. "Yeah, but she preferred that her son-in-law was David Cameron, or Tony Blair's Tory version, but you're not the only one. With me she's always been very demanding, that's why I want everything to be perfect," Victoria answered seriously. "Well, my father is not easy either, you know that he is angry with my sister because she left with her Brazilian boyfriend to spend Christmas in Brazil, and does not understand that a mature and divorced woman can do whatever she wants with her life. Well, let's hope they both behave well on Christmas Eve," William said with a snort. The next day Victoria was back in Dr. Mary's office, and was preparing to go back in time. This time her memory went to Christmas 1838. Once again, the celebration was very joyful for Victoria and Lord Melbourne, at the Christmas Eve dinner and the subsequent dance party included, at Buckingham Palace. Victoria and Lord Melbourne danced, chatted, and laughed together, while him told Victoria funny anecdotes about his past, especially his Christmas when he was young. Victoria was rapt, very happy, seduced by the irresistible charm of Lord Melbourne. As for him, he was also in raptures. Lord Melbourne acknowledged to himself that this beautiful, cheerful, and charming young woman had given him back his zest for life and happiness at Christmas. Letting himself be dragged by Victoria's unstoppable euphoria, Lord Melbourne lived the party with enthusiasm as he had not in many years, perhaps since he was a young man newly married to Caroline, before the birth of his first child began to fill his life of pain. Lord Melbourne danced with Victoria and other women, talked and laughed, and drank. He allowed himself to drink more than he used to drink at social events, especially at the court, even more than his prudence advised. Victoria also drank much champagne, although not as much as in the ball of coronation that happened that same year. As the night progressed and the party came to an end, earlier than usual in order that majority of guests could board their carriages and return to their homes, in the middle of the cold and snowy night. Victoria called a corner, to Lord Melbourne. "Lord M., wanted to ask you to wait a little before going to your bedroom," said Victoria, referring to the guest bedroom that Lord Melbourne had at the palace regularly. "I wanted to propose you a Christmas adventure." Despite his semi-drunkenness, Lord Melbourne was sober enough to find that worrying and raise an eyebrow with suspicion. He was not wrong. "But ma'am, it's very cold. Do you want to get sick?" Lord Melbourne asked seriously and worried. "I would not mind suffering from a small flu just to do so," Victoria replied, disdaining the problem. "But that's... I do not know how to say it, ma'am, but the Queen and her Prime Minister in the Garden of Buckingham making a snowman on Christmas Eve, it seems crazy. I am afraid that they will question the sanity of Your Majesty and the mine, if this is known," replied Lord Melbourne. "Nobody will find out. And if they do, let them say whatever they want," Victoria said, snorting. "On the other hand, ma'am, you and me walking alone in the palace gardens at night, that would surely be considered scandalous, very inappropriate," reasoned Lord Melbourne. Victoria blushed. "But Lord M., we are often alone," Victoria replied. "Working on official matters, ma'am, or walking by day, in places conveniently open to the sight of many people who can attest to the correctness of our meetings. But at night and the two alone, I do not think it looks right and acceptable," said Lord Melbourne, nervous. Victoria thought for a moment and then spoke. Well, we'll have a couple of chaperones, Victoria replied decisively. A while later, confused mind of Lord Melbourne wondered what effect alcohol had had on his decision to accept that absurd whim of Victoria. Both walked through the palace garden, followed at a discreet distance by Miss Scarrett and Mr. Francatelli, the palace cook, who to the surprise of Lord Melbourne had been summoned of chaperone together with Miss Scarrett. Later, at see them together, Lord Melbourne thought that Scarrett and Francatelli were more than co-workers. Lord Melbourne understood that Victoria wanted to recover part of her childhood at Christmas, and making a snowman with a friend was one of those things that were done at Christmas that she had not been able to do. But he could not help but think how ridiculous it was that on Christmas Eve, with the cold it was doing, just a few minutes before it had stopped snowing, and in the dark palace garden, she and he were making a child snowman. But Lord Melbourne knew that he would do almost anything that those beautiful blue eyes and that sweet and joyful voice would ask of him, even descending into the underworld for her. Lord Melbourne placed the lamp, with which had illuminated the path of both, on the floor to light the place where they would make the snowman. With their hands covered in gloves, Victoria and Lord Melbourne began to collect snow in handfuls and to place them quickly and enthusiastically on top of each other, to shape the snowman. They both laughed while encouraging each other with fun phrases or pranks, constantly working. Often their hands brushed against each other as they laid the snow, and then Victoria felt that her body was being traversed by an electric current. Lord Melbourne and Victoria looked each other in the eye, and their gazes were intense and excited, and it did not take an expert in matters of the heart to know that there was a barely suppressed attraction between them. With their enthusiastic and cheerful work, the snowman was soon erected. A big snowball, with another one a little smaller on top of it, and a third ball even smaller on top of the second one like a head. Victoria pulled from a bag that she brought a carrot that put the snowman as a nose, and a couple of glass balls that put it as eyes. She also put a hat and a scarf. Wonderful snowman, ma'am. I must congratulate you, exclaimed Lord Melbourne laughingly. I had a great helper, Lord M. I see you have not forgotten your experience of the juvenile years, Victoria replied. There are things that are never forgotten, we really did a lovely work, ma'am. But maybe we should go to the palace, I do not want you to catch a cold, and I do not see your chaperones, Lord Melbourne said as he turned his head and realized that Miss Scarrett and Mr. Francatelli were nowhere to be seen. But there is another Christmas tradition that I would like to experience, Victoria replied with a mischievous smile and gesture, while placing her right hand behind her body hiding something. Another tradition? If it can be done inside the palace halls. I really do not know where your chaperones went, so, Lord Melbourne answered, but then something interrupted him. A snowball hit him lightly on the shoulder, and Lord Melbourne saw the gesture on Victoria's face, between embarrassed and amused, with a childlike joy. Ma'am! Do not tell me! Exclaimed Lord Melbourne amazed. Please, Lord M. With Lazen I could not do it, and still less with my mother. I've always wanted to have a snowball duel, Victoria replied between embarrassed and pleading, with anxiety. Ma'am, I understand your feelings, believe me, but ask to me, to hit you with snowballs, that's, Lord Melbourne answered a little exasperated and bewildered. Them do not have to be hard blows. Them can be soft, so soft that them seem symbolic and only to the body. I can even dodge them so you do not feel guilty, Victoria begged. Ma'am, Lord Melbourne answered. Victoria's face was covered with a sad gesture that broke his heart to him, and Lord Melbourne cursed himself for falling into the emotional blackmail of the girl. Just some balls, to please you, and then we go in, said Lord Melbourne in a somewhat harsh tone. Victoria laughed and jumped happily, making Lord Melbourne laugh. She took a snowball from the ground, but I hesitate to use it. Go ahead, ma'am. I am willing to be shot, said Lord Melbourne teasing and ironic, while opening his arms. Victoria smiled brightly and threw a snowball that hit him squarely in the chest. With a sigh, Lord Melbourne picked up a snowball on the floor and with nervous gesture in the face, threw it to Victoria slowly and smoothly, but Victoria stepped forward and the ball hit her in the belly. "Come on, Lord M. I had to advance a few steps so that it would reach me. I know you can do better," Victoria said mockingly. Victoria hit him with another snowball in the chest, and Lord Melbourne responded with a ball that caught her in the forearm. Little by little, they exchanged snowballs, until Lord Melbourne himself became enthusiastic. And soon the Queen and the Prime Minister were exchanging snowballs in a more or less enthusiastic duel, while both were laughing, and then a snowball thrown by Lord Melbourne reached Victoria's face. Lord Melbourne apologized, very embarrassed, but she laughed. "I'm not going to accuse you of treason for that, Lord M.," Victoria exclaimed, laughing. Lord Melbourne also laughed. After finishing the laughter, Lord Melbourne insisted that they enter the palace, and she accepted satisfied. But when they started walking, stepping on one of the paths that cut through the gardens and that was frozen, Victoria slipped and almost fell to the ground. Desperate, Lord Melbourne took her by the arm and pulled her towards him, but then it was he who slipped and fell to the ground on his back, and Victoria fell face down on his body. "Lord M., did you hurt yourself?" Victoria exclaimed in anguish. "No, it hurts, but I do not think," answered Lord Melbourne, but he fell silent. Victoria was lying on him, and their faces were very close to each other. Victoria and Lord Melbourne met each other's eyes, an intense look, full of love and desire. Lord Melbourne's mind was still affected by alcohol, barriers of inhibition were low. Desire was winning the battle to the reason. At that moment, Victoria felt that her heart and breathing were accelerating, she felt her body trembling, and it was not for cold. At that time, they were simply a man and a woman who wanted each other, who desperately wanted a kiss. Victoria closed her eyes and approached, and Lord Melbourne did nothing to stop her. Almost their lips were going to rub. "Your Majesty," called the impatient and nervous voice of Miss Scarrat. Victoria and Lord Melbourne regained their sanity, and he helped her stand aside and quickly stand up, but trying not to slip. Soon they saw Scarrat approaching, quickly followed at some distance by Francatelli. "Ma'am, I've seen Baroness Lazen looking for you in the gardens with some servants. I'm afraid she noticed your absence and maybe she thought something happened to you in the gardens," Scarrat said, blushing, and Lord Melbourne wondered what maid had seen. "All right, let's go inside before Lazen puts all the servants and guards to look for me and warn all of England," Victoria replied, somewhat angry and disappointed, with her frustrated desire. "Ma'am, I think I should wait a few minutes to go back alone. I do not want to wake up unpleasant rumors or encourage misunderstandings," Lord Melbourne said, ashamed. "You're right, but do not take long, it's very cold, Lord M.," Victoria replied. Victoria returned accompanied by Scarrat and Francatelli, while Lord Melbourne watched them go. Victoria turned her head, and saw him standing on the path. It was the last memory before Dr. Mary woke her up from the hypnotic trance in the present. "That Lazen is a killjoy," Victoria exclaimed after a few minutes, making Dr. Mary smile. "Now I know that both were very in love, that gaze is the same as William, my husband, in the present when he sees me, but then, how could they live after separating from each other?" Victoria asked sadly, almost with anguish. "I think that's the key to everything, Victoria," Mary replied enigmatically.